толку малим кон ватетува. И вот здесь по целине, да.
And you're very welcome to Capital Sports 3.0 on this wonderful Wednesday evening. We're going to do a very, very short little show. This is a preview for Sunday. On Sunday, we have a massive star-studded lineup. Esult Cody, our legal eagle, is back. I just wanted to warm you up, or cool you down, or freeze you out a little bit with that little snippet from a Russian mountain, where basically the final part in, I'll translate in English, is that like, you know, Sergey, you've just wrecked the whole mountain. There you go. So I'd like to bring into the studio Mr. Andrew Flint. Andrew, look, before we go on any further, Manchester United are going to win the FA Cup, aren't they?
Absolutely nailed on, for the simple reason that there's no logical reason why they should. And of all clubs in world football right now, they are the most dysfunctional, illogical club known to man. I mean, the FA Cup, Alan, you grew up watching the FA Cup. Everybody does. Everybody around the world does. That is the tournament over the history of football that has stood the test of time. Manchester United are in an FA Cup final, and yet it feels the worst possible qualification for the grandest stage of all. It doesn't make sense. And because it doesn't make sense, we'll have no problem steamrolling Manchester City 1-0. Easy.
So long as it doesn't go to penalties, because this is why.
Bernardo Silva! Bravo, Lunin! Bravo, Andrei!
I mean, as my granddad used to say, and my dad then said, who played soccer at a good level, my granddad said, these lads do nothing all week but just kick a ball. That's all they do. They just practice kicking a ball. And it comes to Saturday, Sunday, or a Wednesday night, and they can't. I mean, I'm sorry. That was horrible. Listen, how bad is it that only Aston Villa have gone through, or is it West Ham? Or West Ham or Aston Villa?
Aston Villa squeaked through on penalties, yeah, I think they did, didn't they? Yeah.
I think it could be at West Ham because David Cameron isn't too sure himself. Sorry, that's a joke. David Cameron, West Ham, Aston Villa. Anyway, two different teams, two different cities. But anyway, look, a quick minute on the absolute collapse of English football in Europe this year, because it's been very bad. Liverpool humiliated, West Ham. That second leg, I really have questions over the officials, but they shouldn't have left it that late if they were good enough. You know, they were beaten fair and square, but it's been a terrible European season for English football.
Well, what I would say is, I wouldn't say the entire season has. Simply, this week has been a catastrophic collapse. I mean, actually, one weird compliment I'd pay UEFA, and I very rarely like paying compliments, but I do secretly quite like this coefficient race, which has been the obsession of English clubs recently, because the top two clubs at the end of this season collecting points on clubs' performance this season will determine how many get into the Champions League next season, and it was a race to be the top two to get five places. And it really did look like England were going to finish ahead of Germany and Italy, the other two highest ranked sides that thus far. And West Ham against Leverkusen, to be fair, I think was one of the most important games. And Hammers were looking all right. They really were looking all right until late on in that side. Suddenly, Carlo Ancelotti, I mean, you got to love him, but somehow you never felt it was in doubt that he would just frustrate Manchester City. I'm heartbroken to see Manchester City get knocked out of Europe, of course. Atalanta, again, completely outfoxing, outthinking, outplaying, outperforming in the first leg at Anfield, certainly, Jurgen Klopp's homecoming tour. Suddenly, it paints the whole season badly. I don't actually think English clubs have been too bad. Bayern Munich, before the Arsenal tie in the Champions League, were worried about Arsenal. I was listening to a lot of German journalists on podcasts, and they were saying Bayern know they're the underdogs in this one. I mean, Bayern Munich as the underdogs to anybody is nonsensical, but that is how worried they were against Arsenal. Suddenly, Arsenal out, Manchester City out, Liverpool out, and England have no chance, realistically. I mean, it's about a 1% probability that the odds are for them to get the fifth Champions League place, which is not something that I care about at the moment.
No, no, of course. Even regardless of that, it's funny because in Ireland, Irish League of Ireland fans always speak about coefficient. Andy Mack, coefficient for Scottish clubs. It is something that matters. If I was in charge of UEFA, which I would never be allowed to be, I would just say, right, scrap, champions are champions, and then filter it down. You could even have five different leagues, five European competitions. As it stands, I mean, it's pointless for Man U to go, okay, we've seen some great breakthroughs from Moldova, from Gibraltar teams, they're doing well and so on, and Irish teams. But once you get into that top level and make the money, I mean, Arsenal are going to be back next year, Liverpool are going to be back next year, and so on and so forth. So
I agree with you. I think it takes away from the importance of when you're actually in the competition, because, you know, as long as you get top four, that's enough to keep going in this cycle. Arsenal are the classic case. Pretty much always get top four, very rarely realistically challenge, despite being obviously a very talented side, rarely realistically challenge to actually win the Champions League. And I never forget the greatest season in football, regardless of who you are. For me, of course, completely biased, was 1999. And I never forget Martin Edwards, Manchester United chairman at the time, famously saying, we shouldn't even be in this competition, having only finished runners-up the season before. He said, it's not a Champions League. But we both know, obviously, the blindingly obvious reason why that is never, ever going to change, and it's only going to go in the opposite direction. More and more teams, effectively, well, next season, the Champions League's new Swiss League format is as close to a Super League as it was ever likely to be.
Andrew, it's now, it's basically a Swiss cheese competition because it has so many holes in it. There's no logic. It's a disgrace. Now, one main thing we're going to come on to speak about tonight, because we'll come back onto it at the weekend, because we'll have a couple of experts in with us as well to discuss it. That is, of course, the fallout from the ARD and New York Times expose on a very, very strange moment for Chinese swimmers at the last Olympics in Tokyo, where basically, I think it was 23 of them had apparently, you know, failed doping tests or had been found with stuff in their system and so on. And of course, swimming, no one is ever surprised of it. You know, from Mr. Petey from the UK, all the way, like all these guys who were just flying through the pool, all the Americans, when they come out and start screaming about, for example, a swimmer who she had to have doped, Michelle Smith de Bruin from Ireland, she was still slower than most of the Americans, most of the foreigners who, you know, just basically were out of form. She beat them and they quite fell. There's one thing just to start it off, how they are basically, there was a press conference today from WADA, and I'm going to just show you just some of the things that have gone on around this, because it is an absolute matter. How would you say? It's an absolute mess, this whole situation. Andrew, we'll discuss in just a moment. So this is basically today. The whole thing broke out when this came out. So this is related to the statement. So ARD documentary, it's a German company documentary. Of course, it was organized by Hayes Salpelt. He's the German, a very, very good journalist. He basically walked away from German sports when he saw doping going on and doping in general and swimming. But he himself has dodged coming on with us a number of times. He's been invited onto Capital Sports because we wanted to ask him straight questions. He's been cut out by some grifters and some really dodgy people as well. But this is the whole situation here about the Chinese swimming. They had the press conference today, didn't really answer that many questions, but there were lots of questions about it. Basically, that they had been found with this same drug that a certain Russian ice skater, figure skater, have been found with as well. This is one that you really don't want to take. It's one that you don't really need. It's not healthy. It's not good, but it was found. They said it came in through the vents at the hotel, but then the swimmers are saying it's different hotels. It's a whole mess. WADA knew about this, didn't bring it up. But this is the whole thing, that the agency had no basis, okay, under the WADA code, the World Anti-Doping Code, to challenge JINADA, that's the Chinese anti-doping, that it was environmental contamination. Okay, so that was also accepted by World Aquatics. That's, of course, the governing body of all, well, I'll say, water sports in a dodgy sense, and a bit of smile as well. So this is all over, that this is found in the samples, but they said that there was a reason they couldn't challenge it, and so on and so forth. So this is a genuine, real excuse. It's a crap excuse, but it's an excuse all the same. Now, when we go on to that, the Chinese, when it all came out, okay, so when it all came out, the Chinese, of course, reacted saying this is fake news, this is against China, and of course, they would say that, wouldn't they? They would say that, because the Russians said the same thing, even though there was evidence of doping in Russia. There has always been evidence of doping in Russia. There will always be evidence of doping in Russia, because that's what elite athletes do. They dope. I'm sorry, that's just a matter of fact. Now, this is what China came back with, Xinhua, their state media, and it's something that, you know, said it's misleading, okay? So the swim report is misleading. So they had come up with, like, win clean medals, clean sport. Now, for many, many years, we've known that Chinese athletes do dope. It's been clear as day that they do it. But they're saying that this has been, you know, media bias. It's also geopolitical. It's a push against China. And they've also said that, Chirada said, they've noticed several foreign media organizations published and circulated misleading reports about Chinese swimmers testing positive ahead of Tokyo Games, that they conducted doping tests at a national event in June 2021 and found swimmers testing positive for extremely low concentration of this TMZ. TMZ, of course, that's not the entertainment channel. So they were found this in their system, said, oh, well, you know, it came in from this. So even small, low levels of it, how to get to the system, this is the whole question about it. They said they carried out an investigation, the accommodation, use of medicine, supplements, as well as doping test procedures. Combined that, they said that they had tested positive after being inadvertently exposed to the substance through contamination. We've heard this before as well. Contamination, it was in my shake, it was in my bloody kebab. It was like the girl I was kissing had snorted cocaine. All my mom's cancer medicine had fallen off the table where we were making pasta. All this nonsense. So FINA, that's of course now the World Aquatics, and while they were informed. And again, this is very much, when we know who is bringing this up, again, a former guest of our show, Tariq Panji, who's very, very good. He was involved in the investigation as well, reporting on it. But this is ARD. ARD, the people who are behind it are all working with German intelligence, they get fed by German intelligence, and that's fine. But there's a bit too much of a, let's just say, geopolitical bias on this one, for sure. Andrew, before we have a look at two more pieces from people who really should know better, they were found within their system. So already USADA, the US Anti-Doping, they're the ones who kicked up holy war, but they brought it all to light ahead of the publication of the article and the broadcast of the show. So this is USADA, Travis Tiger, the man who never saw a brown envelope that he didn't turn up his nose at. This is embarrassing for China, embarrassing for America, embarrassing for sports. If you were ahead of, you know, the Olympics, would you immediately just strip the medals, or would you wait?
I think it's an impossible thing to take such drastic action, because then you've set a precedent. And on the other side, on the other hand, you should argue, well, sort of morally, perhaps you ought to just say it doesn't. You know what? I've had enough of level of responsibility. Anybody caught with any trace, zero tolerance effect, might be the most, I don't know, the simplest way in theory, but you simply can't do that now, because then you'll have endless cases saying, well, hang on a minute, you've blanket banned them. How about that medal I should have won because of, it'll be a mess. It'll be a complete mess. Basically, I think they're in an impossible situation. I mean, look, it does not matter how much guilt or innocence there is on the part of the athletes, Chinese athletics in a slightly wider scale or not, whoever it is who is brought to light, they know if you just shout loud enough, there's a chance you may cast enough doubt on it, you may just about be able to win a case just by shouting louder, even if they, let's be honest, Nobody's trying to pretend, no matter what your political bias is, whatever your sympathies are, nobody's trying to pretend that they haven't had some more knowledge than they're claiming, whether it's the coaches, whether it's the athletics organisers who organise the accommodation, the athletes themselves, somebody knows a lot more than they're admitting. Nobody's That's pretending true. Otherwise. But then sort of if you do this to them, then everybody's, you've got to backdate it to everybody else. You've set a precedent. It's a legal case now.
Exactly. Just look, as a question, where do you reckon China, with a country with a population of over a billion people, and with a good track record in swimming as well, because again, it's one of those sports where if you dope the right way, you can win because it's all about strength and stamina. Where did they finish in the medal table, do you reckon? First, second, or third?
Well, I mean, the pressure's on them as a serious Olympic nation. And weirdly enough, I don't think there are many countries that would probably put the Olympics at the very, very top of their sporting pinnacle. No. USA, Russia, China, effectively the big three. China, I mean, historically, Great Britain tend to flop in previous Olympics until recently, and I can't quite draw the parallels to why that sudden improvement in form has come about. Wheels keep spinning around rather quickly, don't they?
Where do you reckon in the medals table for swimming alone, where did China finish?
I can't see them finishing above the United States. They just simply traditionally are the home. I'd say second or third is about my best guess, simply because that's where they're always going to finish if they don't win. So second.
Well, this is the one thing, okay? This is the one thing that you're going to like this, okay? Because you've actually led us into it. So here is where China finished. Fourth. They finished behind USA, Australia. Of course, Australia never dope. I mean, we've discussed that Robin Barsotto, who opened the can of worms about how doping was very prevalent in Australia. Great Britain. And then China. And of course, ROC, and Japan, Canada, Hungary. Okay, all the good countries. Germany, of course, a very good history, and Italy as well, very good history. They're finishing well down. South Africa, France, always a good history. We had a very bad one. Sweden, very good history, very bad Olympics for them. But the top of the table, USA, and Australia, Great Britain, and China. That's what I always figure. Where is this riddle, Andrew? Where all these countries, Russia finishing in the top couple, doping the heads off. But all these other countries who are finishing top of the table, they're so clean. They don't dope, nothing like that. And Andrew, it's surprising me. And Andrew, one thing that this is now when you know that the shark has well and truly been jumped well across, when you get people who basically pick and choose their battles and are very much again fed into by, and this isn't some conspiracy, they are actually fed directly by intelligence services who basically gather information on different sports. Russia does the same. Does anyone think fancy bears are not related to, some agency somewhere? No, they were. They all are. It's just how they play it. It's how they do it. Information is money. Information is glory. Information is power. This is Christine Brennan, who, again, as I said, should know better. But she puts this out that they were betrayed by the system. Chinese swimmers, positive test, race question before the games. Now, of course, straight away on USA Today, you have LeBron James, of course, another man who has lots of questions hanging over him for what he took and didn't take. And this is going on about, how many medals America's Katie Ledecky or Frances Leah Marchand will win in Paris. Katie Ledecky, again, someone who is has been very, very successful, has done very, very well. And again, because she's American, no questions asked whatsoever. This is going around the world, and they're pointing fingers across at China. And as with many people who will be almost soon, like Thierry Gondry, they haven't caught the elephants in the room, and the elephants are definitely not China. They're definitely not Russia. They're the ones, the big money pigs, like Australia, Canada, America, and UK. Andrew, to wrap it up on this, I'm just going to ask you to lead us out. China, we know, they're as guilty as anyone else. They are doping. That they've a history of doping. It's how they get to the top of the medals table. Now that they're part of the axis of evil, as we heard the other night, China, Iran, Russia, God knows who else, probably, I don't know, Ireland soon. if we're lucky. Will we see removal of politics from doping? Will we see actually everyone just stopping, saying stop? Because again, the anti-doping associations or authorities, agencies, it's not their fault. They're not doping. They're not injecting athletes. We do know that some of them cover up for athletes. USADA, Travis Tigers, is famous for that. Serena Williams phoned him and said, I'm not taking this test. And she didn't take a test. Russia covered up for failures. UK anti-doping did the same. Irish the same. But will we see a day when basically people will grow up and just let kids play?
I'd love to say yes, but realistically, we know the answer is no. I think more likely is there will just simply be, as there always are, newer, more efficient, subtler, smarter, you might say, ways of avoiding testing. And testing is always going to be playing catch up to whatever new way there is to beat the system. And I say beat the system, it's all very well and good saying, and justifiable in one sense, to be all moral about it and say, look, sports should be clean. Well, yes, it should be clean, but do you want to live in a dream world or a realistic world? It's just simply, this is what sport is nowadays. And one of the things that I think is a real shame is it should never be accepted as part of the game, part of the sport. Well, it's the edge you've got to get, just like running a little bit harder, well, cheat a bit harder. That it should never be that way. One of the things I do find creeping in, and I think this is where we're heading, if you take a very popular sport like football, for example, you'll get a lot of Latin American countries, European countries, who simply take pride in conning referees, conning the system, trying to win a free kick. They see that as part of the performance. There is a performance in it. I mean, I'd love to say, honestly, it shouldn't be part of sport. And going back to what we were talking about, how much people will stamp out, collectively say enough is enough about doping and cheating, I think it's more likely to become accepted as part of the sport. That is part of tactics. How well can you get away with it? Because no matter what we want to say, everybody wants to win. And if everybody else decides to be clean, there will always be one who will say, great, that's a more opportunity for me. And as long as I get away with it, it's not my fault.
And that's where we can leave it. Again, just we can watch out for Kate Ledecky. She'll be 27 with these games. Again, it's an embarrassment. From what has been released in US media, she's been tested twice this year in the build-up to the Paris Olympics. Of course, that's one of the most decorated swimmers of all time for America. Andrew, on that note, thank you very, very much. We'll see you on Sunday back for a very, very big show. Have a great week.
See you then, boss.
Okay, and we will go out in just one moment because both Andrew and I will, I guess we'll just let you enjoy the last little bit of fun on this Wednesday evening. So until Sunday, take care of yourselves and each other. Stay on for this little video.